Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to another session of NMIMS Knowledge Series, Redefining Leadership. My name is Varun Mathur, and on behalf of NMIMS Global Access School for Continuing Education, I welcome you all for this session. Today's topic, workplace diversity and inclusion. Well, if you talk about this topic, it's there on in everyone's mind. Every leader, every organization has now started practicing this. They have imbibed that in their culture. Why we need to understand why is it so important? Why are organizations preferring to build an inclusive leadership, preferring to have diversity in their workforce? To answer some of these questions, we have today with us Chief Resource Officer from Wellness Forever, pharmaceutical company, Ms. Smita Sahu. Ms. Smita is there with as a CHRO. She carries more than 18 years of work experience. And she's an alumni of XLRE Jamshedpur. She is a veteran in the HR industry. I mean, she has an exposure and experience in talent acquisition, talent management, development, and HR branding. And as a company, Wellness Forever has grown leaps and bounds in last 11 years. It has grown. It now has more than 176 stores across the country. In fact, as what Smita mentioned to us, Wellness Forever is a company that is on a mission to create one of the most respected chain of pharmacies across the country. So it's a pleasure that Smita is here today with us, and I would like to invite her to share with you how workplace diversity and inclusion, what are they and how it can impact an organization.
Where is that on mute and done? So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome all of you and thank you to this NMIMS who has given me this opportunity to really interact with you. Now, is there a slide which will come?
Yeah.
Did you do that? Enter. Okay. Okay. So this is one of the topic, diversity and inclusion. I think every organization, do we have a choice for that? When we are actually into the globalizations, technology is really one of the enabling factor, and we do not have a choice at this point of time to not to talk about this diversity and inclusion, because if we do not have this, then probably organization would not be successful. So with that, I think when we are all bound to have to live with this kind of diversity culture, so what is that important for all of us? So for me, diversity, is it a skill? Is it a disruption? Is it a strength or is it a weakness? So if I look at all this thing, probably we do not have a specific answer to that, because this topic is so vast that if you go to internet, if you search in the Google, everybody is talking about diversity, diversity, diversity. What is that diversity? Okay, just how to see my slides, where? Just a minute. Sorry, we have to leave a little bit of deck. Okay, this and this. Okay, so diversity is, I think diversity is everywhere. In a very simple words, what appeals to me is that it is to embrace the uniqueness. Every individual is unique, every group is unique, and just to embrace the uniqueness within us to and say that we are living in a diversified culture. So when diversity represents our differences, our race, religion, gender, sexual orientation, age, socioeconomic culture, even physical abilities also, but diversity has very, very limited value addition when there is no inclusion. So inclusion refers to a cultural and environmental feeling of belonging. In our words, you know, when you talk about most of the organization, particularly in India, I don't know about, we'll discuss about how it is being perceived in Western culture, but most of the companies in India, what they feel that they carry the target of recruiting many women employees, creating women leader. Is that only the diversity? Sometimes we feel that we have done a good job if we have achieved the target of recruiting or hiring X number of women employees and we have developed X number of women leaders in the organization. But sometimes we forget that how we have enabled that, how we have enabled a system, environment, ecosystem to really make that a diversified culture. So I always admire one of the very famous inclusion strategist who is there. You can refer to the TED talk, and Werner Meyer is one of the very famous inclusion strategist, and she has her own company also, Werner Meyer's company, as a consultancy on diversity and inclusion. If you look at the LinkedIn, she's the inclusion specialist in Netflix today. You know, in a very, very simple words, which always is one of my favorite statement, she says that diversity is being invited to the party. So inclusion is being asked to dance. So it is as good as when I said that when you are hiring and achieving the target of hiring as a part of your gender diversity, some X number of women employees in the organization, that's you're inviting them to be a part of your organization. But when you're creating and enabling a system for them to deliver the best and really create an inclusive culture, so that is called our inclusion. So with that, let me tell you that this is something which I come, I'm working in an organization called Wellness Forever. And when I joined this organization 1 year back, probably I could see a real diversity. Let me share that experience with you. This organization started 11 years back, and this has been started by 3 first generation entrepreneurs. And by religion, one is Muslim, Ashraf Biran. One is a Sindhi who comes from Punjab, and one is authentic Maharashtrian Hindu. And when I entered that organization for an interview, I was wondering, all the 3 promoters were sitting in one room and they operate from one room. And when I entered there, the first statement was that don't get shocked. We operate in this way, and we eat together, we work together, and only thing that we don't do is that we don't sleep together. That's something which is, I think, the best example for a diversity, that how, and till date, 11 years, this company from 4 stores, they have grown to 176 stores, and probably they have their differences, they have their different views, opinions, but the only thing that has worked is the inclusive leadership. So for me, that is one of the things that what I see in our organization, when I, that changed my perception, that 3 different kind of people from different religion, the way they work together, there could be a lot of companies and there could be a lot of promoters from this kind of background, but the way they work, that talks about inclusive leadership. And the growth story of this organization tells that diversity cannot really make an impact unless there is an inclusive leadership. So something I would like to really bring, that this is okay, I am getting some chats, so yeah. So let me okay, fine. I think a lot of questions on tips to deal with diversity, different castes, definitely we'll come to that. I think one chat has come, your voice is not connected, but now okay, great. Okay, so when I am talking about the organization that I am working with, you can really link into the many famous organizations. There are many more, but I think some of the organizations that really touched me when we talk about diversity and inclusion, that is Tata is an organization everybody would agree that how they have really established themselves with a diversified culture, diversified people from different countries, and it's actually really talks about a global diversified culture with high amount of inclusive leadership style. So I'm very close to IIA. I go to Jamshedpur because my family lives there. So when first time I had gone, I saw that it's a beautiful city. And one of the things that from the inception, how the Tata has perceived Mr. Jamshedji Tata, when in a letter to his son, Dorabji Tata, he said that let us create a township where you have to earmark for different religions, for Hindu temple, for Muslims mosque, and for the Catholic church. So 150 years back, this is Tata when they carried that sense of diversity and inclusive leadership with them. And today they witness a success, and no doubt, no one can deny the fact why they have the one of the biggest Indian multinational in the globe. So likewise, I think Microsoft, L'Oreal, Visa, Unilever, recently I was studying some time back, they have a separate prayer room for Muslims for their prayers. So that has become a news in many HR forum and magazines. And they have their transgender hiring policy, they have LGBT hiring policy. So they encourage a lot of gender, the women hiring programs in the company. So if you look at Nestle, has also a lot of programs which encourages the growth mindset of in the diversity field. Visa is also known as their very different kind of empower the employee, and they really encourage inclusive leadership in the organizations. So you can see, we don't need to talk about it, how Microsoft has really built that. And they create Microsoft specifically, they create something in the digital space, that inclusive digital diversification, something about that. And these people talk about it in different, you can go and see that how Microsoft takes a pride in creating a diversified culture. So when we are talking about diversity and inclusion, let me give you our own example. Few days back, I was listening to one of the interview by Mr. Kapil Dev, who was the captain of India and the 1983 World Cup. He was sharing his own story, and that really struck to my mind why he is he could win the World Cup, and what is the differential leadership that he brings to the table that he could make that India win in the World Cup. He was asked that, what was your challenge in that when you are dealing with different kinds of people? There are so many, the entire team is from different parts of the India, and what was your main challenge? Then he said that probably language is one of the thing, and he was asked that whether somebody would like to hear Kapil Dev's English or Krishnamurti Sharishrikant's Hindi. So he said that it's better that Kapil Dev's English than Krishnamurti Sharishrikant's Hindi. So it speaks about that when you deal with all sorts kinds of different languages from coming from different cultures, so making them and bringing to them to one platform and creating a success story, it requires a lot of inclusive leadership style. One question, let me take it, which can literally show the world how diversified a company is. I'm working with and where anybody can apply. No sex orientation asked, no religion asked if you have it, and you are selected. Yeah, when you're saying Kapil Dev is a good leader is when you are dealing with diversified work group, when can you prove yourself as a good leader? When you have an inclusive leadership style, you cannot be a, gone are the days when you can create a leadership and you can use that autocratic style. And when the, you are dealing with a diversified team, you have to be, you ought to be an inclusive leader to create the success stories. Some of the questions I would really like to park it. I will take it in the last part of the session. So we have been talking about diversity. Diversity, is that diversity is enough for to keep it as a policy guideline, or diversity is only successful when there is an inclusive leadership? I would rather focus on an inclusive leadership when diversity is something which is inevitable in our in the kind of current state of affairs, the globalization, the technology. So what do you mean by inclusive leadership? One of the question that I see, that why do we talk about diversity when you can literally show that the world is diversified? Of course the world is diversified, but how do you really enable that diversity in an organization to be successful? You need to be an inclusive leader. Without inclusive leadership, the diversity has no meaning. You will have people from different caste, religion, race, gender, and then how would you really bring them and to a coherent state and make them work and make them deliver to their best of the performance? So I think the inclusive leader is some of the core quality of inclusive leadership is that he has to bring awareness and clarity to problem areas. So when there is a, they gather, the bringing awareness and clarity is nothing. They try to understand the pain areas in the D&I. Giving an example, suppose you have people from different gender, okay? So unless there is a awareness and clarity to those, their pain areas, their issues, their challenges, probably the leader cannot really establish a connect with the entire team. The awareness and only can come when you try to go and seek the input, go and seek the feedback from them, and then you try to bring a connecting thread between you and the entire diversified workforce. Then another quality that inclusive leadership is has to display is practice courageous accountability. It's not many leaders, they shy away from the responsibilities of, and they feel that this may not work and this is the way that I need to operate. This is the only way that I can really operate. And this is a very, coward leadership style when they shy away from this kind of thing. I'll give you each example in different companies, then that will really clarify your this core characteristic of a inclusive leadership. So unless we do as a leader, there is a very, very clear cut thought about the clarity about the D&I pain areas, and they commit to holding the themselves and other responsible for addressing those areas. Unless you really, you have the courage to take that ownership, that to confront that situations and really resolve their problems. And the third one is empowering others. This is a very, very generic statement, appears very easy to people, but I think this is the most difficult one when it is practiced. When you empower others, you have the trust and respect has to be built in within yourself. You need to trust people, you need to trust them, you need to really give them that space that they can work freely, and they can, you need to believe on their deliverables. And the fourth one is the foster innovation and collaboration. Of course, when you have a diversified workforce, I think innovation is inevitable, because if you are open to different perspective, if you are open to different ideas, if you are you get multiple thought process from multiple source of information and multiple cultures, I think that foster innovations. And if you really stuck to one particular as a leader, that this is the way that I should only consider this part of the perspective or this part of the ideas, probably innovation comes down. And as an inclusive leader, when you open up yourself to get those ideas and perspectives, that makes you really create an environment of innovative culture. So some of the example, let's go back to the awareness and clarity. I will just give you an example, which is in the Accenture North America CEO, Julie Sweet. I think, you know, there is a racism happening. The can I get a glass of water? There was a racial, there is a motivated act of violence in America, and the CEO Julie Sweet could get a feeler out of it, and he started inviting every employees to a conversation. She dealt with individual employee through mailers, through communications, and what is it all about? And she could bring that lot of clarity and could arrest the situation within the company. So when you give the clarity, when there is a ambiguity, there is a lot of doubt in the people's mind, I think the biggest thing that we can do as inclusive leader to clarify their doubts, to clarify their whatever their speculation in their mind, and that requires a lot of awareness and clarity. What's happening in this organization? When you have a diversified workforce, probably certain things that will you feel that's happening around the market and what is happening around the ecosystem, probably you need to have that awareness and bring clarity to the people. That creates a lot of engagement within the leader and the team. Practicing courageous accountability, I think one of the example I can give that PwC US Chairman Time Rand, you can read it, who actually introduced this inclusive leadership style. And again, in the wake of a racial violence in the protest in multiple US cities, Tim Ryan, what he did that he initiated a conversation with thousands of employees, what he calls through an honest and respectful manner. And sometimes the conversation was uncomfortable also. And he had the courage to face the entire workforce to see that whether he can really establish the connect with the employees and himself at the time of this crisis. And he could build the confidence amongst the employee. And that requires a lot of courage at the time of the crisis, when you really gather that courage and face the employees and share your thoughts and the questions, the observations from the views from the employees. It's Tim Ryan. It's Tim Ryan, T-I-M-R-Y-A-N. So that requires a lot of discomfort, handling a lot of uncomfortable questions, uncomfortable situation, but you need to have that courageous accountability. So when empowering others, I have many leaders in mind. I think one of my favorite leader in all time is Martin Luther King, who's one of the philosophy is that unless you empower others, you will not be really empowered yourself. That is something which is, he has followed it religiously, and I don't need to talk about Martin Luther King. Sir Martin Luther King, the way he's been respected as a leader across the globe. And there are others also, a lot of examples, empower others, Mr. Ratan Tata, the way he has established the big empire in the globe. I think he believes in empowering others, and he believes in unless you empower others, you cannot feel empowered. You yourself cannot feel empowered. And innovations is many companies. I think one of the examples that I was reading an article published by Russell and Reynolds, one of the global consulting firm. And of course, I mean, Amazon is one of the fostering innovation is what I could see the chat, the way they have really done the diversified workforce. And I don't need to talk about it, how Amazon has really established as an organization, innovative organization through diversified workforce and with a lot of collaborations, empowerment. And that's something which is that talks about what is that inclusive leadership. Yeah, so on and so forth. I think Google and many other companies, and when it comes to the innovation, probably we have a laundry, we have how many thousands of organizations who has created this kind of story around the diversified workforce. When we talk about this inclusive leadership, I think some of the interpersonal and the own self qualities that you need to the inclusive leader, they have displayed that when it comes to interpersonal, some of the things that I would like to talk about it is the open dialogue. When you really create and encourage an open dialogue, very few leaders, I mean, they are scared to start an open conversation because they have something in their mind. If these things comes to us, how would I feel? And I think many, many leaders, they shy away. In your work areas also, you will find many leaders. But the inclusive leader are the ones who foster open dialogue and to get that awareness and clarity. Because unless you are open and transparent with the entire diversity, because the diversified workforce has different kind of culture, different kind of religion, and everybody, they come with a different kind of personality. Even it happens in our home also. When you see that in our home, there are people who are from different parts of the India, you see that because everyone is different. So it's very important for an inclusive leader to foster open dialogue. And to at a self level, what are the motivation, what are the privilege, and what kind of acumen do I have as an inclusive leader? One has to do that kind of self-awareness and bring that clarity to the oneself. It is for the self. Then when it comes to that, holding self accountable, taking that ownership is one of the intrapersonal quality that really encourages a courageous accountability. And coming to the third point, when it comes to empowering others, empathy is one of the things that is non-negotiable in any leadership. If you want to be an effective leader, forget about an inclusive leader, empathy has to be a part of. Without that, I think nobody can really operate that, take that leadership chair. And developing with feedback. Feedback is a process. I think it is most of our HR professional feel that feedback is a part of our appraisal process. It happens. But feedback is a continuous process to develop self, to develop others. And feedback not necessarily has to be always I think feedback is something which is every feedback you can always convert that as a constructive feedback. And if one wants to really get into an inclusive leadership style, I think developing with the feedback is very, very important aspect in that entire journey of inclusive leadership. And innovative collaboration, I think when you have a diversified workforce, the reading the situation, challenges, leveraging differences to read. I think differences actually takes, creates and opens the path for a lot of innovations. And when you do not have a difference of opinion, then probably the innovation stops there. Okay, I'm getting some chats. Again, the chat windows are gone. Of course, people like to work for such kind of organization, and you can also make your organization. Why are we always talking about, yes, Google is there, and I just spoke about shared with the organization I am working with. And I think if everybody, the leaders, you can mold the leaders to really create that kind of culture. And let's not only restrict ourselves that because these are the organization, they are really driving diversity and inclusion. If we want, as all HR, I think all of most of them, you all are in the HR professionals who are in the participant list today. So we can also create that awareness in amongst our leaders. We can drive a diversified and inclusive culture in our organization. So of course, Google once when they started, they were never a diversified culture. They must have started with the zero, and today they are being the most diversified culture and with inclusive leadership. So we can also do that in our organization, and nothing stops us to do that. So I it's again, So what are the some of the things that crucial traits for inclusive leadership? I think humility. Where this on this point, let me just share my own experience. I'm not going to Google I'm just trying to give you some example how to bring inclusion in diversity where there's a local language constraint. Let me just share my own work experience in this company. Probably let's not talk about Google because they have already established it. When it comes to humility, they're modest about the capabilities. You know, the organization I work with, the three gentlemen who sits together and operates for the entire company, and we are around 176 store with a top line of around 1,000 crores company, and we have a big dream to achieve. You know, the first thing when I met them, when I had my induction with them, they said that, you know, Smita, we do not know much about human resources. Can you please help us to make us understand what is good for our organization and get us there, because at least you coach us, you mentor us. And probably hearing these words from a promoter, I think these are the kind of humility, and that's the reason from a 150-60 stores to in last 3 years they have almost touched 176 stores, and we are in a growth path, and we're going to be around 305 stores across India, and these 305 stores what we are planning to have is only within the three states, Maharashtra, Karnataka and Goa. This is my own experience, what I'm trying to share, that humility is something which non-negotiable thing in any leadership, if and that is inclusive leadership. How to bring inclusion is something I think you need to create that awareness amongst the people, because unless you talk about why humility is needed to be successful, then probably people will not be able to understand, because you know this is a trait, this is a character that you need to develop. You can't say that, hey, come and please show the humility from tomorrow onwards. It is a journey, it's a personal experience, it is an emotional experience. You have to demonstrate certain behavior, and you have to really showcase certain behavior which has been shown by other leaders and how it has impacted the organization. If you have this kind of thing, bring and instill that sense of achievement through humility, by showcasing, by talking about it, and I think that would really make a lot of difference, because you can't afford to be arrogant and be a great leader. You can't do that, and many people have failed that by being arrogant. So there is no methodology that you can bring inclusion, because it you know, this inclusive leadership is at a mindset level. It just can't happen that you just tell them these are the traits and characters of a inclusive leadership, and you can really start showing and demonstrating from the next day. And when it comes to, you need to be a little open and create the space for others to contribute, because unless you create the space for others, then you will not be able to make them contribute. And that is called humility, that I do not know is something which will really opens the path for a great organizational success. And I do not have, somebody had put this question, how to bring inclusion diversity? It is only by talking about it, demonstrating that, and creating role model in the organization that how humility has helped the organization to be successful. Awareness of bias is something everybody, they have some blind spots as well as flaws in the system, and work hard to ensure meritocracy. See, biasness is not, again, it doesn't, you cannot make understand that when you are being biased, when you know, sometimes it happens that many leaders, they show the biasness without their knowledge. And when you tell them, in many of my experience, I go and tell them, particularly when it comes to HR, I think at the time of appraisal, many a times we shy away to tell that there is, if there is a biasness is happening, we feel that we don't have any role to play in there, in that kind of situations. But believe me, when you go and explain them with some kind of logic, some kind of rationale, this is not, nobody, no leaders would say that, okay, fine, you are telling a wrong thing. And for that particular, to tell something, I think you need to be unbiased. And then only you can bring that particular blank spot in front of the leader, saying that meritocracy is a non-negotiable traits in the inclusive leadership. And many organizations have been successful by eliminating this biasness. And curiosity about others is something which, how much I know are my people, that is something which is a, again, another trait, how much we our relationship with the leader and the worker, the workforce, doesn't end with that. It is not a work relation, that what is the task has been given to you and you are delivering. It is about knowing about your others. What are their mindset? What are the challenges that they are facing? One of the example in my Blue Dart experience, I would just like to share. We had a few expats, and the expat was really facing a lot of challenges in terms of acquainting with the Indian team. And one day I thought that, because I saw her sad face for a couple of days, and I thought, let me just try it out and let me try to engage with her. What is the problem? Then, you know, she shared with me that, okay, fine, nobody understands me, that what I am saying, and they don't even call me to the lunch. I eat my lunch alone. And I'm trying to make friendship with them, but I'm not able to do that. I think they are these kind of curiosity to know what is the problem happening with the other person's mind. What are the challenges they are facing? This is just a very small example I gave. You will have physically disabled people. You will have transgender. We'll have people from different race, religion, culture. So probably getting into their minds and what are their feelings and how to know that. Nobody is saying that get into their personal space, but really understanding their whatever they can share with you. I think that is something, and for that you need to be curious like a child, what's happening inside the mind of the people. And let's not be judgmental. That is one of the most important thing when we are trying to curious to know about others. We need not to be judgmental. We are there to really help the entire diversified workforce, to enable them to be successful. The fourth one is cultural intelligence. Is something, you know, when we hire a lot of expats or we go to work in other countries, I think that intelligence should be known as when you are in that leadership position. What is that that really matters to them, and when they come from a different culture and they're attentive to others' culture and adapt as required, is something which every inclusive leader at least invest that kind, that much of time to know about the cultural intelligence when there is a diversified workshop. It is not only the global, if you in India, you have, India is such a diversified country. If you go to South and if you go to East and North, I think extremely different in terms of food, in terms of language, in terms of how they behave, how they talk. So probably that intelligence a leader should at least have. And the effective collaboration, because there is a general tendency for many leaders that they work in a kind of environment when they feel comfortable. But I think we need to get out of that. And effective collaboration is a inclusive leadership trait where, yeah, somebody has raised the hand. I will, if you can just put it on the chat board. Yeah, of course. This is what, if a company wants to initiate the diversity and inclusion in an organization, then what are the steps that HR team need to follow? See, diversity and inclusion is not a HR agenda. Diversity and inclusion is the agenda for the entire leadership team. HR, because why it is put as the HR agenda? Because HR is a people facing department, and it's a softer way when it deals with the emotions and it deals with people's mind. So HR comes to the front end the entire diversity and inclusion. I think yes, how to what are the steps that HR has to put lot of guidelines, and as I said in the beginning, guideline policies and programs are just enabler, and how you are actioning it, that is important. How much you really passionate about to action themselves through others is something which is important. You can have gender diversity program by enabling hiring policies, by creating good ecosystem for the women employees, women employees who come serve after maternity leave. You can have any number of programs to enable that as HR person to enable this inclusive leadership in the organization. So it is, I agree, it's not at all a HR agenda, it's a leadership agenda, it's an organizational agenda. You can have, as a HR, you can have your policies like specially abled, I mean, how many of us really advertise that this position only specially abled people can apply? Answer is no, because it's an organizational agenda. The moment you start as HR that we have this policy, you go to the leader and they say that, how come it can be only for the specially abled? Probably we need to bring a balance in at that point of time, and we need to create that mindset in the organization and say that how diversity can really, and this, suppose you are recruiting, hiring a specially abled workforce in the organization where you feel that this particular kind of work can be handled by them. So probably that awareness you have to bring in the leader's mind that this is where you've been also contributing to the society when you do this. So please do not think in that mind, this is a HR agenda. HR is an enabler. HR can bring policies, programs, but HR has to action with other in a collaborative manner to implement an action in an organization. Of course, this is inherent. If I talk about, okay, fine, just let me just touch upon this point. When you talk about diversity, diversity has two parts to it. One is the inherent, one is the acquired. So when you talk about inherent is which caste you come from, which race you come from. These are your inherent, which culture you have come from, and which kind of work background you have come from. These are inherent, you can't do anything. This is called diversified workforce. But when it has come acquired is something, how you are enabling them. Do you really plan for a washroom for especially abled people in the company? So these are acquired is something, how you treat them, how you create a sense of belongingness, how you create engagement with them. What kind of plan do you have as an organization to create that ecosystem so that diversity works? You can, of course, adopt these traits by, as I said, you have to create that ecosystem. And, you know, diversity is something, it's a mindset transformation. You have to foster that structure. You have to change the mindset of the leaders and try to bring that element. What is that inclusive leadership and why you want? Unless you give them the answer that why it is beneficial, why it is important for an organization, and the more you do, they would definitely agree that when the employee feel valued, when the employees feel respected, when the employees feel a sense of belongingness, they are more productive and they can really work wonder and they can really make the organization successful. When you say I'm trying to acquire inclusive leadership for past 6 months, is it you or is it your leader to create that environment amongst your leader, that I'm not sure, but if you're trying to acquire inclusive leadership, you need to be inclusive first. You need to really embrace the uniqueness of every individual first, and you need to really see within yourself how much inclusive you are as a person. I think that everything follows, because empathy is something, how much empathetic you are, how much respect you give to others, what kind of value system that you bring to feel others respected, how much you trust, that is something which you need to do that. And if you just try it, I am trying to be a really inclusive leader, probably that doesn't happen. Any leadership, anything is a mindset, and you need to practice it. You need to consciously practice it and try to instill those traits within yourself. So definitely when it comes to Sir Martin Luther King, in all my life experience, I think one of the things that I really admire him as a leader, because his philosophy about leadership, somebody asked me that in the past 6 months, please listen to his last speech, I have a dream, and probably that will change your mindset, that I, what you are trying to acquire and how you can really do that. I do not have a magical solution for you to acquire that, but definitely this, I think if you talk about leadership, he's one of the statements that really touches me, is that life's most persistent and urgent question, what are you doing for others? The moment you get that answer, then I think you will become an inclusive leader. A lot of things to really learn from his leadership style, and probably if you get time, please listen to his speech, I Have a Dream, so that will really open up a lot of mind block for you guys, or for all of us to be an inclusive leader. And what are the benefits if you, somebody who's asking how to do that, unless you really give the answer of why, what are the benefits of a inclusive leadership, and how the organization have been successful by being displaying this inclusive leadership, I think that would really make a lot of change, that would really bring a lot of change amongst your leadership team, that this is what we can do as an inclusive leader. It improved the job satisfaction when every employee feels valued, respected, and they get a sense of belongingness, they become more productive and they give more to the organization, and they empower the group to perform beyond the sum of their parts, and they become more and more loyal to the organization. And when you have a diversified workforce, then the different thoughts, perspective, ideas, when you sum up everything, then you really become and create an innovative culture, and you never know which idea really works for the organization. And I would really share a story about innovating, how the diversified workforce create innovation. The Caterpillar HR director, there is Ms. Latasa Gilapia, organized team based on diversity in gender. It is a, Caterpillar is a very highly diversified, they have a diversified workforce, and they were facing downward trends in 2015 in parts of the sales for one of their business unit. At the same time, they were trying to find creative development opportunities for the high potential talent. So the HR leader, what they did, they organized team based on diversity in gender, geography, background, generation, language, the different function, and they included some people who had no experience in this aspect. And they, while they did that, many saw the approaches as very risky, because you are really taking a lot of chance and risk about it when you bring all these diversified workforce and try to brainstorm on these things, how to really come out of the downstorm. But they took the risk, and somebody had asked me what action HR should take when there is a, you see that kind of scenario, you take the proactive step, how to bring the together and how to bring them in a collaborative way, and the entire thing that worked in their favor. The team generated around 57 million in incremental sales and above and beyond the recoveries that the business produced using the traditional methods. So this is something which I think one of the examples that I would wanted to give when there is a downturn, and this is what done by the entire HR team. And there's a lot of risk in this, but they could really gather courage taking that accountability, and they could really do that. So what actions, so what can we do to create an inclusive environment? We can educate our leaders how the D&I initiatives can really make difference in the organization, how D&I can really create a heavily, highly employee engaged engagement in the diversified workforce. And probably what you can do is you can create a formal inclusion council where you can really brainstorm what could be done for the company, what kind of programs that you can run and you can really action implement in the company. And this council needs to be diverse as much as possible. And I think celebrating employee differences is one of the most important ways to show employees that you respect their background, which we many of us do that. I think that we celebrate Diwali, we celebrate Christmas, but beyond that, what we can do to really celebrate the differences, their views, their perspective, their ideas, I think that's something which need to go beyond these festival celebrations. Engaging with them in different forum and understanding what they want, what keeps them motivated, what is that there. You can create focus group to understand and celebrate this kind of differences. And the last one is listening to employees is something, because unless you really connect with them, unless you really understand their feelings, their aspirations, so I think that something which you need to listen in different kinds of modus operandi. Probably you can have surveys, you can have skip level meeting, you can have, but I think the moral is that how you can connect with them to listen to them, their thoughts, their ideas, and their that will create a lot of belongingness amongst themselves. And the last one is that, do you really communicate with them what are their goals? Why are they in this organization? How to measure their progress? What are our inclusion goals? Because I think D&I program, if you can run it, you can have multiple things run, different initiative, but what are our objective of having an inclusion goal? What are the reason for this goal? Why are we driving this D&I initiative in the organization? And how can you quantify? Probably what we do most of the time, we have a lot of program, women leadership, different hiring program, and the specially abled people, the hiring for the specially abled people, and really making different culture and from different religion, race, we have a lot of program we drive. But how do you quantify these inclusion programs? That's something which we need to put structure in around it. And how that inclusion, because every company has a mission and vision for that, and how this D&I impacts our mission and values, whether it is embedded in our core values. And these are the some things, certain things before you put your programs and initiatives, these are the things we need to ask ourselves, that what is our goal, what is our objective having this D&I thing, and why we are doing it in our organization, something that we would really try to ponder about these questions. You know, this is one of my favorite example, is that when symphony master, they run an orchestra, they face towards that all musician, and they do not face towards the customer, and his back is towards the customer. You select these people for an orchestra, they have a different musical background, because somebody is playing guitar, somebody is playing violin, somebody is playing harmonium, whatever, I mean the musical instruments, and that comes, when that comes together, that forms a beautiful sound, and this is something which is, we can build that inclusive workplace by having that kind of synergy and collaboration, because when the different sounds come, they form a beautiful musical sound. And the same way the D&I can work, when you have a different workforce on different culture, race, countries, religion, from different technology, from different globe, parts of the globe, you can always form a beautiful music the way the symphony master does that. We as a leader can do that. I think, yes, of course, I talked about that, how we can improvise on the group dynamics, because that's something which is very, very important, and it boosts the trust, it boosts the communications, it enhances the focus, clarity of thinking, because when you have a diverse workforce, it allows everyone to see that everyone is different and the value everyone brings to the table are different, and they bring a lot of perspectives, ideas, and that balance, the that complements each other's strength and weakness, and that strengthen our group dynamics. So, you know, we talked about a lot of things, traits, behaviors, and the lastly I would like to really talk about is that there is an advantage when you have a diversified workforce, because you know the strength and weakness, they complement each other. Only thing that how you can really bind this diversified workforce is through an inclusive leadership. And as an HR professional, when we have D&I specialists in our organization, they drive a lot of programs. Please understand that before you drive this, explain the objective to the leaders, because do not take all the ownership on your shoulder that this is my agenda. This cannot be HR agenda. This is the agenda by leaders, by organization. And in that process, please try, let us try to create an inclusive leadership. First, when you want, we want to create inclusive leadership, we need to convert ourselves as an inclusive leader. Then only we can build that kind of culture in our organization. Whichever organization, let's not talk about Google or Amazon or could be Microsoft. Why can't we, wherever we are working, we cannot create our work culture as a inclusive work culture? That is something which I always feel that we all can do to start with. And it's not about taking a target about how many women employees I will recruit, how many specially abled person I will recruit, or but enabling them. Can you think of having a ramp when you are recruiting or hiring a specially abled person and they come in their wheelchair? So can we think up about that? So we need to expand our thought process to have an inclusive culture in the organization. And the moment we start doing it, things will start changing. I don't know if I can, you can share the PPT with the participants, that you can share that. Yeah, so yes, of course, any questions that I've, anything, I think, of course, we can do that and we can create a wonderful workplace, and everybody would agree that happier employees are more productive, and we have a very critical role as a leader to create that kind of workplace in our organization, an inclusive workplace. I can take questions if anybody has the questions. Speak in Hindi, people understand easily. Okay. Yeah, many of you have requested to speak in Hindi, but but I am not very comfortable to really explain in Hindi. I can do that. If any specific question that you would want me to answer in Hindi, I can do that. Can you elaborate inclusion goals with one or two example inclusion goals? Okay. Okay, but inclusion goal is, inclusion is a goal itself. And when you are talking about Okay, I will give an example, a goal, because in the company I'm working, when I joined, I could see that many pregnant women are moving across on the floor, and during the afternoon, after their lunch break, they feel they just sit down on the ground in our washroom, and when I asked them, they said that we are feeling a little tired and we are not in a mood to work. Then I thought about it, and I see these are not the goals, but these are certain things that has created certain goals in my mind, that as we are growing, we'll have more and more women employees, and we will see more such cases in our organization. Why can't we think of a place where all the pregnant women can really relax, and we can create an ecosystem in that entire room that they feel good? And that's our goal. I set a goal that it's not my ad hoc arrangement. Let's make a goal that I want to create a best state of the art facility for the women employees who comes here and they are at the pregnancy stage. So that I made that goal before I really jumped into. I could have got a bin bag and or maybe a bench and put it in a place saying that this is where you can sit down. But today, really, let me tell you, because I could put a goal, we have a room which is having babies' photos and every arrangement, and someone really feel good about it to be in that room for some time when one feels that I am really feeling tired or I just need to take rest for some time. I think these are the kind of inclusion goal. Probably we can do that. Suppose you want to really hire some transgender in your organization, put a goal what you want out of it. It is not just to showcase that we are transgender in our company working. So what is that you are going to achieve if you recruit transgender? How can you enable that transgender to be a part of your organization? What are the things that you need to build for them? And then only you can make a comprehensive goal plan. Then only I think you can really create that kind of ecosystem around you. I hope I could answer your question. So I think the time is off. That's what one question I can take. So thank you so much. I think I had a very, very nice interaction, and thank you for a lot of questions. Thank you guys. Thank you so much.